Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to the episode before the last during this blessed Ramadan. Bismillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala nabiyyihi wa mustafa, Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah, wa ba'd, all praise be to Allah alone. We all praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show Him guidance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and send peace and blessings upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our phone numbers, brothers and sisters, are beginning with area code 002-0238-555-248-249. And the email address is ask@huda.tv. And the Facebook address is msalahofficial@facebook.com. Barakallahu feekum. I would like to begin by answering Muhammad from Ghana. He had four questions. The first, with regards to al-masbuq, if somebody joins the imam in the later rak'ah, the imam has already begun his prayer and he joined him later, and the imam upon finishing the prayer is making two prostrations for forgetfulness, because eventually he had forgotten something before Muhammad, for instance, have joined him. His question is whether should he join him, or since I was not involved in the rukn or the part of the prayer where the imam have forgotten anything, that I should neglect these two rak'ahs and go on my own. No, you should follow the imam from beginning to end. So even if the imam rises up from the middle tashahud and he doesn't do it, you should follow him. Even though you know that you should be sitting and making the tashahud, but you follow the imam. So if the imam by the end makes sujood sahu, you should follow the imam as well. إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُتَمَّ بِهِ. Second question of Muhammad is, a traveler who may shorten and combine the prayer. I will make the question a little easier by giving an example. He had prayed Maghrib and Isha together, combined at the time of the earlier prayer, which is Maghrib. Then when he reached home, there was still some time for the Isha prayer, because the last time, the deadline for the Isha prayer is midnight. So he has arrived before that. Does he have to make up the Isha again, re-pray the Isha, because he arrived home within the time of Isha? No. You prayed it once, that's it. The fard was fulfilled. Because when you prayed, you were already on the travel distance or still traveling. His third question is, MashaAllah, he seems like a wealthy person. He says, every month I already have the nisab. The nisab is the amount which, if you possess for one complete lunar year, that you should pay zakat 2.5% on it or against it. And the nisab is equivalent to 595 gram of silver, or in gold, 85 gram of gold. No, you don't have to pay the zakat monthly, but by the end of the year, since the time that you already possessed the nisab, by the end of the year from that date, you start counting the 12 months and the one complete lunar year from the day that you became wealthy and you possess that nisab, you estimate how much do you have and you pay zakat on the total amount. Some people like to pay on their salaries as they receive them because they already have the nisab. That's fine. But the easiest way is by the end of the year, you estimate how much total you have and you pay the zakat on all of that just once. His last question is very interesting, which is, what about getting married in Ramadan? You can get married on any month or any day. Some people, you know, they have the understanding that you cannot get married in Shawwal, you can get married in this month. No, you can marry any time. And in Ramadan, yes. But the thing that you have to keep in mind, that during the days of Ramadan, while you're fasting, you're not allowed to eat, to drink, or have sexual contact with your spouse. This is the thing which you might find it a little difficult, especially for newly married couple. It's hard to keep your hands off. It's hard to keep away from each other. So if you know that you're going to control your desire, similarly is your spouse. Because I just had a question. Somebody said, I contacted my wife during Ramadan. What is the kafara? The kafara is very, very severe, brothers and sisters. It's a big deal. You have to fast for 60 consecutive days. If you can, you have to feed 60 masakin. It's big. It's really big. Okay? For breaking your fast in Ramadan due to al-jima', having an intimate relationship with your spouse, of course. By the way, whether a spouse or not, it would lead the same to the same, but it will be even worse. It will be an act of fornication, of course. But I'm talking about what invalidates fasting and requires this complicated ransom fidya or kafara. So if you know that you can control yourself, back to this, the question that the person asked me and said, you have to do this and this and that. He said, what? I said, yes. He said, but it was not my fault. My wife forced me. She kept bugging me and asking me. And she says, I said, she too has to pay the same fidya. And by the way, whether she's the one who took the initiative or him, both, each one of them owes this fidya. Because breaking your fast in Ramadan is a major, major sin. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. With our first caller today, Sister Nadia from Egypt. Naam.
Nada.
Okay, Nada from Egypt. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
Naam.
Alaikum salam.
Do you have a question?
Yeah, I have a question.
Please.
What are the signs of Laylat al-Qadr?
The signs of Laylat al-Qadr. Okay, did you pray last night?
Yeah.
Okay, how did you feel it?
What?
How did you feel about it?
What?
Okay, okay. It seems like you have a problem with the connection. I will answer you. I already got the question. The signs of Laylatul Qadr. Okay. Sister Asia from United Arab Emirates. Asia, assalamu alaikum. Okay. The signs of Laylatul Qadr. There are multiple signs. Number one, in Surah Al-Qadr itself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرِ. Then he said, سَلَامٌ هِيَ حَتَّى مَطْلَعِ الْفَجْرِ. I want you to imagine that the earth is already full of angels, including Angel Gabriel, peace be upon him. تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ. They descend abundantly. They fill the whole earth. So that would lead to a state of peace, a state of tranquility, and the shayateen will run away. We said in the beginning, from the beginning of Ramadan, صُفِّدَتِ الشَّيَاطِينَ, that the very rebellious jinn and shayateen have been chained. So even the little ones, now, during this night, when the angels descend and fill the earth, they spread peace and tranquility. Salam. It's a peaceful night. That includes everything, even the weather. The weather is mild, is neither hot nor cold. And if it rains, that's also a sign. It doesn't have to rain, but if it rains. One of the very prominent signs of Laylatul Qadr does not show during the night itself, rather after it's all over. Why? So that the person who have started the prayer during this night, he's sincere in his devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not just making business. Somebody will give him a call and say, yeah, we realize that it is Laylatul Qadr tonight. And this person was watching a talk show or playing games. And then since it's Laylatul Qadr, he got up and he went to the masjid to catch the last two rak'ahs. No. Upon sunrise, when you look at the sun rises exactly like the moon. You look at it, it's so bright, it's so beautiful, without those rays and the ultraviolet which would hurt your eyes. You look at it as if you're looking at the moon. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, Sister Rahma from the KSA. السلام عليكم.
وعليكم الشيخ.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. رحمة how are you؟ بارك الله فيك. I really love to know how old are you.
7 years old.
ما شاء الله. بارك الله فيك. May Allah bless you and your family. Did you enjoy this Ramadan, Rahma?
What?
Did you enjoy this Ramadan?
Yeah.
ما شاء الله. Beautiful. Alhamdulillah. شكرا. Okay. Do you have a question?
Yeah. One question. What will happen to the kids on the day of judgment?
What will happen to whom on the day of judgment?
Will they die or they will go to Jannah?
Okay. Okay. May I get your question, Rahma? Thank you. Sister Asia is back on the line from Emirates. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Asia. Yeah. It's obvious now the problem is on your side. I mean, you have a very bad connection. We cannot hear a word. Please try again. Okay? What will happen on the Day of Judgment? It's called the Day of Judgment. That is the biggest court ever. And the judge is the most just, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will be able to distinguish between the righteous and the wicked. First of all, the disbelievers, those who did not believe in Allah as the only true God, they will be taken on one side and they will follow their false deities. Those who are worshipping idols will go with the idols to fire. Those who are worshipping cows, those who worship in whatever, they will go to fire. Then remains only those who believed in the oneness of Allah, whether from the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our most beloved, or the followers of all the previous prophets, those who were mentioned in the Quran and those who were not mentioned. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَأْتِ النَّبِيُّ وَمَعَهُ الرَّهْطُ ويأتي النبي ومعه الاثنان ويأتي النبي ومعه الواحد ويأتي النبي وليس معه أحد. On the day of judgment, some prophets would come with their followers, a bunch of people. And some prophets would show up with only two followers. Can you imagine? And some prophets would show up with only one. And to the extent that some prophets would come with no followers whatsoever, but they have delivered the message. So they will take the believers and they will be saved. They will receive salvation on the day of judgment, after the intercession and the reckoning and so on. So the believers of every ummah, there will be a hisab pertaining whether the good deeds were heavier and greater than the bad deeds or not. Not simply because you say, I believe in Allah as the only God, you just go straight to heaven. No. You are commanded to execute a lot of duties, rights and obligations in order to be eligible to enter paradise. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, one of his best companions, O Mu'adh, أَتَدْرِي مَا حَقُّ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ. Do you know what's Allah's right upon his servants? He said, Allah and his messenger know best. He said, حق الله على العباد أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا. Allah's right upon us is to worship him alone and not to associate any with him in worship. Then the second question, he said, O Mu'adh, أَوَتَدْرِي مَا حَقُّ الْعِبَادِ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Do we have rights upon Allah? Allah the Almighty gave us rights. Do you know what are our rights upon Allah? He said the same. Allah and his messenger know best. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if they do worship Allah alone, then Allah will give them salvation and he will not punish them. But for the sins that the person committed, he will be purified for that. That's why we have to make certain that we repent frequently and regularly, right away upon committing the sins, so that when we show up on the day of judgment, we have no sins, inshallah. and especially the sins pertaining others, human rights, because it's not easy to forgive those sins without going to them and asking them to pardon you. So from the beginning, why do it? No backbiting, no slandering, no stealing, no hurting somebody's feeling in order to be saved on the Day of Judgment. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Muhammad from United Arab Emirates, assalamu alaikum.
Yeah, assalamu alaikum, Bashir.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
This Ramadan Huda TV programs are very good, especially the blessed nights.
Alhamdulillah, barakallahu feek. May Allah bless you all.
And I wish it is extended throughout the year, like the dark where we have every chapter discussed in detail.
Inshallah, we'll consider that. Barakallahu feek.
Yes, I have three questions.
Now.
Two on Zakat. My first question is, I have to pay Zakat after what I have in training.
If you do me a favor and raise your voice just a little bit, I can barely hear you.
Yeah, I'll increase my volume. I have to pay Zakat with what I have with today, the cash.
Well, if your Zakat is due today, then you have to pay Zakat on all what you have, and also the loans that you may have given to somebody else. And the stocks and the cash and everything.
Yeah. My question is, I lost my job last Ramadan, and I'm just living out of my savings. And also I have some loans to pay, like no car installment.
No.
Is it possible that I should postpone it, or you should have to pay?
Okay. Your situation is you lost your job almost a year now, and you have loans. But you have money which is zakatable. When you pay the zakat on this money, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you prosper. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلَ فِي كُلِّ سُنْبُلَةٍ مِئَةُ حَبَّةٍ. The smart believer knows that if you'd like to be rich, give in a charity. This is even extra beyond the mandatory zakah. But as far as the mandatory zakah, whether you have a big job or you don't, whether you are as rich as always, or this year you're broke and you're not making much profit, but you still have the nisab, there's no question about it. You have to pay the zakah. Because guess what? The zakah, the portion in your wealth, is not yours. مِمَّا جَعَلَهُمْ مُسْتَخْلَفِينَ فِيهِ. This money is not yours. You're just a delivery man. You're supposed to take this amount of money and give it to those who are eligible, to those who deserve it, to the poor. So you don't have the right to keep it or to save it or invest it or say maybe next year when I prosper a little bit. And inshallah, when you give your zakah on time and even give extra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you and you will find a better job, and you will see, inshallah. You have two more questions, you said. Okay. Sister Fawziya from Qatar. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, first I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who guided me to earn the knowledge of Islam through Huda TV.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. By the grace of Allah.
I have been watching Huda TV for the past 7 years. Jazakumullahu khair.
Since the beginning, yani. MashaAllah.
Yeah, since the beginning, yes. Alhamdulillah. Yeah. And I have learned and understood many things about Islam from your program.
Alhamdulillah.
And of course, as your logo goes, let Allah make Huda TV the light of Islam in every home.
Ameen. Ameen, Ya Rab. Ameen. Barakallah feek.
Sheikh, Jazakallah khair for every person who works with Huda TV. And I have some questions, inshallah. I have three questions. The number one is about Sajda Tilawat. And when you read Quran, when you recite Quran, when you get sujood, can we do sujood after Fajr and Asr Salah if we are reciting Quran? And then another one, the what is the way of performing the sujood? And what should we say in the sujood? And my next question is, like Rasulullah has said that there will be 73 groups in the Ummah and only one group will go to Jannah. So our concern is how we can follow the correct way to be in this group which Rasulullah has mentioned. And at times we get confused when some people say this is not the correct way, this is not an authentic hadith, and so on. Okay, and then my next question is about wudu. Just a few days before, when I was in the mosque and I was doing my wudu, one of my sisters, she said that when you start washing your hands and washing your hands three times, washing your mouth three times, you have to wash your hands and legs also three times. It is not that you wash three times and hands and legs one time. I didn't understand her, but I just want you to clarify this about this and about the intention of itikaf every time when we go to masjid. Can we do the intention of having itikaf every time when we go inside the masjid? Like for example, when we go for Taraweeh Salah, for Isha Salah and Taraweeh, and we stay till Qiyam al-Layl, can we make the intention of itikaf?
Okay.
I
already have plenty of questions to answer to the end of the episode, mashallah. Thank you, Sister Fawziya. Do you have any other callers? Brother Ahmed from Bahrain, salam alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, Sheikh. I hope everything is well with you in Ramadan.
Alhamdulillah, more than wonderful by the grace of Allah, mashallah.
Sheikh, my uncle passed away early morning yesterday before Fajr.
Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raj'un. May Allah have mercy on him.
Ameen. Jazakallah khairan. Inshallah, make dua for him.
Yes, of course.
My question is, brother Sheikhna, my wife told me that she had heard previously on Huda that my uncle's sons will have to cover up for the remaining Ramadan fasting that he would have otherwise fasted if he was alive. I want to clarify this point.
This is not true. Whoever passed away, all the duties of this person, whether it's he or she, have been dropped. He's dead. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. How can Allah ask somebody to do something after his death? Or ask his ears to fast on his behalf because he was supposed to fast the whole month of Ramadan. That doesn't make sense. That is not true. Okay? But the days on which he had missed and he was supposed to make up, and he could not make up, and he died before that, his family members may make it up on his behalf. But if he was severely ill, and he died in this ailment, it will be sufficient to pay the fidya for those days which he did not fast during his death sickness. Okay, any other questions? Barakallahu feek. Noura from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Ask Huda. Okay. Please try again. Now. Fawziya from Qatar. Sujoodu Tilawa. We say there are 15 or in another opinion 16 positions in the Quran. Whereupon reading them and we see that line on top of the word sujood, that we should make sujood. It's an emphatic sunnah. Sujoodu at-tilawa. If the imam is reading and he makes sujood, whether in the salah or outside the salah, then the audience should follow him. If he doesn't, then they shouldn't. Similarly, if the person is reciting by himself, there are several questions Sister Fawziya asked pertaining sujoodu at-tilawa alone, which is, what about making sujood tilawa during awqatul karaha? After fajr and until sunrise. After asr and until sunset. And 20 minutes before the sun moves away from its median. Yes, you should also make sujood tilawa during awqatul karaha. Simply because it is not a prayer. It is not a prayer. And the scholars differed with regards to sujood tilawa, whether it's a salah or not. But sujood tilawa is not a salah. So you can make it during أوقات الكراهة, and you can make it in any direction even if you don't know the direction of the Qibla. How to make sujood like our regular sujood? The seven body parts will be in touch with the ground, and you will say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la as many times as if you want. If you just say it once, it will be sufficient. There are other supplications such as اللهم احطط عني بها وزرا واكتب لي بها أجرا واجعلها لي عندك ذخرا سجد وجهي للذي خلقه وصوره وشق له سمعه وبصره تبارك الله أحسن الخالقين. I cannot say the meanings now because we don't have time, but you may find it in the book of supplication. Okay. Fatima from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam, Sheikh.
How are you, Sister Fatima?
Alhamdulillah. How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah. Barakallahu fiki.
Sheikh, I have one question today.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to find out, is it possible for me to hold a portion of the zakat money which is already due to be distributed for the zakat eligible people at a later time during the year?
During the year, no. You can hold it maximum for a few days. Like if you're traveling, if you're going to drop it to somebody who lives abroad. But to save it with you or hold it for several months, or throughout the year, to give it like salaries or on installments, because you know that this family needs every month that much, no, is none of your business. Once it is...
Until I go to my home country for about three,
a few days,
right?
A few days, fine. A week, fine. But beyond that, no. Wire the money to somebody who will distribute it on your behalf. You cannot just keep the money with you. There is another solution, which is you can always pay the zakat in advance. So when you go to your home country, pay the zakat to those poor whom you think that they are eligible for the next year. So you don't have to worry about it anymore. Okay? But everybody, please do not hold back your zakat. Claiming that you're going to pay it to some people later in a few months. A few months, no way. That is haram. A few days, perhaps okay. Fatima, any other questions? Okay. Let's take a short break and inshallah we'll be back in a couple of minutes, so stay tuned.
Do that because you do not know what to say to them something. At least you raise up your hand and ask Allah, oh Allah, please give guidance to this brother of mine. The importance of following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. To follow our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam means you must understand his sunnah. Adino Yusrun, Islam is a very easy religion, simple religion. So don't make religion difficult to yourself. I believe this hadith is very common to all of us. But the beauty part of this hadith, number one, it started by Umar al-Qattab saying, Sami'tu. Now again, I'd like to share with the brother and sister to understand the beauty of this saying of the companion.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome, dear viewers from around the world, to our exciting program titled Good Answer. I'm your host, Malik, and I'm joined by the Imam of America, the founder of Guide Us TV. He needs no further introduction. I think you know who I'm talking about, Sheikh Yusuf Estes. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh Yusuf.
Assalamu alaikum, Malik.
My name is Ayman, and I think a lot of people would like to know, a lot of non-Muslims would like to know who Prophet Muhammad was.
We worship the God that he worshiped. And we worship that God the way he worshiped. So we consider Islam to be a way or a deen.
Right.
Anywhere. But that had never been met before. He said, this is a gift, never came before, that me and my followers, we can make our salah, our connection, anywhere.
Hey, sure, you're on the hot seat. I like my seat over here. I'm feeling comfortable. Because he asked you a tough question. He asked you a good question. Can you give him a good answer?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Sister Fawziya from Qatar asked about the hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says this ummah will be divided similar to previous nations, and it will be divided into 73 sects, and only one of them will be saved, which means the 72 sects will deviate and eventually will end up in the fire of hell. May Allah protect us all. She said, what are the traits and the signs of the saved party? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not leave us this question without an answer to give some wild guesses. Rather, he said, when his companions asked him the same question, he said, Ya Rasulullah, which party will be saved? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Hum man ala ma ana alayhi al-yawm wa ashabi. Those who will be following strictly whatever I'm doing today and my companions. And it is not difficult at all to figure out what was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing and his companions. We have the sound collection of the sunnah and the traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those who follow it will be saved. Those who are very keen to do exactly what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do as much as he can, and they avoid innovations, and they avoid inventing in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they would not accept anything simply because it is said by so and so or such and such. Rather, they ask for a proof. They will be saved. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in another hadith, مَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ وَمَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. He said, whatever I command you to do, you should fulfill as much as you can of it. Of course, with regards to the fara'id, the five daily prayers or fasting or hajj, we must fulfill it. There is no option nor choice. But with regards to the voluntary acts, do as much as you can. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. But on the other hand, وما نهيتكم عنه, whatever I forbid you from doing, فاجتنبوه. You must avoid it totally. Do not go near it. لا تقربوا الزنا. إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان فاجتنبوا. You should avoid it. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وذروا ما بقي من الربا إن كنتم مؤمنين. Somebody will say, but Sheikh so and so said, today in the 21st century there is no more riba. Okay, you and him, you go to hell. Because he is making what Allah prohibited lawful. And you believe the Sheikh and you don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, not because somebody said it and you followed him knowingly that he is saying a statement different than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. No one can make unlawful what Allah made lawful, nor lawful what Allah made unlawful. We have to stick to that. So by doing this strictly, inshallah azza jal, you will be among the saved party. The people who follow strictly the traditions and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She said, in wudu, she said, you have to wash three times. This is not true. You can wash three, you can wash two, and the least of the required is to wash once. And if you wash once, then twice or thrice, it is permissible as well. If any person insists on doing something and say, you have to do this, very simple, say, show me a proof. It's as simple as that. We're saying this is what the Prophet ﷺ did. He once washed once, twice, and thrice. And the ideal is thrice. This is the sunnah. But once is the basic and it is the least requirement. طيب. What about i'tikaf? When we spoke about i'tikaf and its virtues, we said, لا حد لأقله. There is no minimum. You can just simply enter the masjid and intend i'tikaf, and you leave after 1 hour, or even less. So we say, especially in Ramadan, when a person is going to the masjid for Maghrib, Iftar, Isha, Taraweeh, Tahajjud. Like the masajid were packed yesterday from Maghrib till Fajr. Why not when you enter the masjid intend to do i'tikaf? I'tikaf is to stay in the masjid with the intention of i'tikaf, contemplation to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during this time. So in this case, yes, it is allowed, and it's also recommended that you accompany your staying in the masjid during this time with the intention of i'tikaf. Barakallahu feekum. As I promised yesterday, I would like to share with you some of the ahkam and the etiquette of Eid. Because as I said, today, inshallah, azajal, is the episode before the last. Tomorrow will be the last episode of Ask Huda during this Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. First of all, I cannot believe it that we're already approaching the end of Ramadan. I cannot imagine how fast the time is zipping by. It's unbelievable. And by the way, this is indeed one of the signs of the Day of Judgment, when the month would look like a day or so. And this is exactly what happened. I cannot imagine, just a few days ago, I was speaking about how to receive Ramadan and how to plan for it, what should be doing in Ramadan, and make sure that we do not waste Laylatul Qadr. It's gone. It is gone. And now, with the celebration of Eid and how to do it. Yesterday we spoke about the mandate of Zakatul Fitri or Sadaqatul Fitr. And we said every Muslim should pay their zakah before the Eid prayer. Because if they don't, then they're committing a major sin. So this is the first hukm and adab, that we have to pay our Sadaqatul Fitr before the Eid prayer. Second, before leaving your house, you should break your fast. It will be best if you break your fast by eating a few dates. The hadith was just collected by Imam Muslim and narrated by Anas ibn Malik. May Allah be pleased with him. He described how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do on the Eid. He said, "Kana la yaghdu." He used not to leave his house in the morning for the Eid prayer before eating tamrat, which means a few dates. Why? To declare that you're not fasting today. Yesterday, fasting was obligatory. Today, breaking your fast is obligatory and fasting is haram. It is not permissible to fast on the Eid day. Takbiratul Eid. Making the takbir as follows, according to the most sound narration in this regard, to say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illa Allah. Wallahu akbar, Allahu akbar, walillahi alhamd. I have a question from one of the sisters pertaining the Eid, and she says, what is the nasheed that is recited before the Eid prayer itself? It is not a nasheed. It is the greatest word ever. The word of the oneness of Allah. La ilaha illallah. And other adhkar such as Allah is great, Allah is great, and there is no one to be worshipped but Allah. Allah is great, Allah is great, and all praise is to be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, Allahu Akbar, walillahi alhamd. Okay, you say individually, if it happens that when we consign our statements together, that is perfectly fine, no problem, as long as we do not make a special setup that is different than the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or his companions. Abu Abdullah from the USA asked about, Sister Wahida asked about praying Eid at home. Okay, that would lead us to the following. Where do we get to pray Eid? The sunnah is to pray Eid in the Musalla. And Musalla is different than the Masjid. And Musalla is an open place, an open area that it can encompass as many people as possible. So we do not pray Eid in the masajid. Yet it is permissible. But the sunnah is to go out, perhaps out of the city limit or in an open area, and one imam and everybody will pray behind this imam. And in the musalla, here is another advantage. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as it is narrated by Ummu Atiyah, may Allah be pleased with her, in the sound hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered everybody to go out for the Eid prayer. Even those who would not normally pray for innocent women during their menses. The Prophet ﷺ said, they too should go out لِيَشْهَدْنَا الْخَيْرِ, to witness the righteousness and the goodness, to share the joy and the delight. Look, every time we do that in our countries, and we see the magnitude of people, people are dressed up nicely, they look nice, they're dressed up like white, and the kids are happy, everybody is celebrating Eid. This scene is the Eid, is the actual celebration of the Eid, in the Eid prayer. So men, women, children, elders, youngsters, everybody should go, even those who would not normally pray. They would not pray, but they would witness the prayer and the jama'ah and would see the Muslimin while they're praying. Her question is, can I pray at home? Well, praying Eid in the masjid is permissible. And if you don't have access to attend the prayer in the musalla, or if they pray in the masjid, Alhamdulillah, excuse me. يهديكم الله ويصلح بالكم. I say it because I know that the director said it in my earpiece, and I believe that many of the viewers have said it. So يرحمكم يهديكم الله ويصلح بالكم. بارك الله فيكم. I was worried of having the flu from the beginning of Ramadan because of the tarawih and the qiyam. Alhamdulillah, والشكر لله. It came towards the end. No big deal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. Now, we're talking about the musalla and praying at home. Many people in some states, they don't have a nearby masjid, and sometimes they're the only people who are Muslims in their city, or the only person. Yes, you can pray at home because it is an emphatic sunnah. Salatul Eid varies between whether it's a sunnah mu'akkada or a wajib. Okay? So since it is an emphatic sunnah, you can pray it at home, whether by yourself or with the few people of your family members, if possible. If there is a musalla, if there is a congregation, then you should go out to attend Salatul Eid. We said the takbirat of the Eid, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in ayah number 185 of Surah Al-Baqarah, وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. It begins at sunset of the last day of Ramadan. And it ends when the Imam says Allahu Akbar for the Eid prayer. So we don't make those takbirat of the Eid afterward, because Eid al-Fitr, and there is another question here, how many days is the Eid? Eid al-Fitr is only one day, versus Eid al-Adha is 4 days. The first day and the following 3 days, which are known as Ayyam al-Tashriq, or 3 days of Eid. So the total will be 4. This is for Eid al-Adha, which follows performing Hajj. So we seize the takbirat of the Eid when the Imam makes takbir for the beginning of the prayer. And we all know that the Imam will make 7 takbirat in the first rak'ah after takbiratul ihram, versus 5 only after takbiratul intiqal in the second rak'ah. It is recommended to take a ghusl on the Eid day before leaving for the musalla, wearing the nicest clothes that you have, and wearing the musk or the perfume that you desire, and go out looking nice wearing your adornment. This is for everybody. Women would do all of that, except that when they go out, they should be wearing their proper hijab. When I say wearing your nice clothes, you do not wear your wedding dress, or you do not wear what you normally wear around your husband and at home. Why? Because you should wear your proper hijab. Alhamdulillah, you perfected your Ramadan in your fasting. Do not ruin it by wearing makeup and tight revealing clothes. Or, you know, unfortunately, especially what I have seen in America, it's a multicultural community, that when we go to pray Eid in the Astro Dome or here or there, you know, many sisters don't even consider the concept of hijab. It's like they're going to a wedding party or going to a nightclub, if I may say. Hair is loose, wearing full makeup and perfume, wearing very revealing clothes. Why? Why is that? Even if you're planning on getting married or looking for a suitor, not in this way. Do not ruin your fasting, do not ruin your ibadah by exposing your beauty and not wearing hijab upon going to the musalla. So gotta keep this in mind. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma used to perform ghusl before going for the Eid prayer. Congratulating each other with the Eid is simply by saying, as it is narrated, that Ashabul Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to congratulate each other by saying, تقبل الله منا ومنكم, which means, may Allah accept from us and from you. And also means, Allah kabul kari. And by that, I end up today's episode of Ask Huda by saying, Allah kabul kari. May Allah accept from all of us. تقبل الله منا ومنكم. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the altar.